My name is Noel Chalmers. This is the larger section today in the tutorial that I'll be covering essentially the syntax of HIP and the conceptually how you would use HIP in C++ programs. There's going to be a lot of little code snippets, but I hope we can all get a sense of HIP by the end of this. So you might have a question at this point, what is HIP? Well, HIP is, of course, just an acronym for AMD's Heterogeneous Compute Interface for Portability. It's a C++ runtime API and kernel language runtime that developers can use to create portable applications that run on both AMD's GCN hardware and NVIDIA CUDA devices. It's completely open source. It's available on the ROCm GitHub. And it is, by design, syntactically similar to CUDA. In fact, most API calls simply resemble CUDA syntax with CUDA replaced by HIP. And currently, it supports a strong subset of CUDA's runtime functionality. There are some things like unified memory, which are still under development, but for the most part, most CUDA API functions are supported. This talk is geared towards people who maybe have heard of CUDA before, but have not coded in before. So if you fall in that category, you're in luck. Hopefully you'll become more familiar both with HIP and CUDA by the end of this. For those who are already familiar with CUDA and have used it in their applications, I'll try to point out and stress not only the similarities between HIP and CUDA, but also the important differences at the current time. But when we're starting out with a HIP or CUDA code, it's important to think that the source code will have two flavors. There will be host code and device code. The host code is your usual C++ application. The entry point to your application is, of course, the main function, and there will be several HIP API commands that you can use to create memory buffers on the GPU, move memory between the GPU and the CPU, and launch GPU kernels. On the other hand, there is sections of your application that will be device code. The syntax for device code is very much C-like. We enter device code regions via kernels, which are sort of decorated with a global attribute. And it's important to note that all code in device sections will be run on SIMD units on the GCN hardware that Renee described earlier. My hope is by the end of this section, all of these API calls will at least be recognizable to you, and you'll understand what each of them does. But this is just a snapshot. I'll give a slide at the end so we can sort of see a refresher. So let's start. I'm going to start from a high level on the host code side of what an application might look like using the HIP API. So first off, we need to put the work from our application into GPU kernels. These kernels, when they're launched, are executed conceptually on a three-dimensional grid. It's maybe more comfortable thinking of this as a mesh that your problem maps to, but that's not necessary. Inside of kernels, we'll have access, each thread will have access to its coordinates within this three-dimensional grid, both in its block and its thread. And you can use either a one-dimensional, two-dimensional, or three-dimensional coordinate mapping. Most problems that we have, just array operations, will map quite nicely to one-dimensional grids of threads. The grid is split up into blocks, and each of those blocks is split up into multiple threads. Each block is identical in size, and we will launch the number of blocks that will be necessary to perform the amount of work that we want to do in our GPU kernel. Those familiar with CUDA, this should be very familiar to you. This is very much what CUDA also describes as its block and thread structure. In fact, just so we have a quick reference here, traditionally, a lot of AMD's terminology has been from OpenCL, where we refer to blocks and threads as work groups and work items. But in this presentation, I'll use more CUDA syntax because HIP is designed to be very similar to CUDA. So I'll use the grid, block, and thread. I will distinguish between a warp and a wavefront purely because CUDA's execution model is with a 32-wide warp, whereas our GCN hardware operates with a 64-wide, what we call a wavefront. So in one dimension, our grid may look something like this, where our problem is partitioned into a grid of blocks, and inside each block is a number of threads. So in this diagram, each block is its own color, and each small square is a thread. Inside of our device code, each thread will have access to its respective block ID, so where that block is in the grid, and it will also have access to its respective thread ID. You can access this through blockid.x and threadidx.x. We also have access to the number of threads in a block and to the number of blocks in the entire grid. In two dimensions, it's quite analogous. Now this diagram shows just a 2D grid of threads, where again each color is its own block, and each block is a thread. And now the API, again, very similar to CUDA for those familiar, each thread will have access to its respective X and Y coordinates of its block, and also its respective X and Y coordinates of a thread within a block. So what would the syntax look like for a GPU kernel? Well, let's suppose that we're starting with an embarrassingly parallel loop. This loop will just loop through the entries in an array and multiply each entry by 2. If we translate this into a GPU kernel, we might get a kernel that looks something like this. First off, the work is done inside of the thread. There's no longer a for loop because this section is device code and will be executed in SIMD. And let's go through point by point the differences between these two code snippets. Well, first, a kernel that will be launched from the host must be declared void with a global attribute. Next, all pointers that are passed to that kernel must be pointers to device memory. I'll expand more on that later. Then it's good to think that all threads inside of this device code will execute simultaneously. I put this in quotes because that's not strictly true, but it is good from a program conceptual understanding to think that this kernel is executing all of its threads simultaneously on the device. And as I said in the slide before, each thread has access to its unique thread ID and block ID, and we can use that to compute a global indexing, which is what I do in that line, computing that integer I. And because all of the blocks are of equal dimension, and there are a number of blocks launched to cover all of our work in this array, there could be more threads than there are N work items to be performed in the kernel. So we do a quick bounce check. This is good practice. From the host side, this is how this kernel is instructed to be launched on the device. So first, we will declare dim3 structs, which will essentially calculate the dimension of our grid and blocks in the grid. So first, this dim3 of threads, it will be 256 by 1 by 1, so a one-dimensional thread of 200, or one-dimensional block of 256 threads. And our blocks will be enough to cover our N items of work that we want to do. So we'll divide our N by 256 and round up. Next, the launch syntax itself will use the hip launch kernel GGL function. If you're familiar with the triple chevron notation of CUDA, this will be very analogous but more C++ 11 lambda type syntax. The arguments to this function are the kernel name, followed by the dimension of the grid, followed by the dimension of each block within the grid, the number of bytes of dynamic LDS space or dynamic shared memory. I won't have time to talk about dynamic shared in this talk, but if you have questions afterwards, feel free to post them in the Google Doc. Then a stream argument, which I will talk about in a moment. And then lastly, all of the arguments to the kernel itself. So you may be asking, why do we bother with blocks and threads when we launch our GPU kernel? And if you recall Rene Van Ostrom's talk a moment ago, this is a natural mapping to GCN hardware. Our hardware will guarantee that blocks will be dynamically scheduled onto each CU in the GPU. And furthermore, all threads in a block are guaranteed to execute on the same CU. And that means that they can share things like L1 cache, and they can use a cache of shared memory. The wavefront, or the block itself, will execute in a series of wavefronts. These are 64-wide SIMD units on our hardware. It's sometimes useful to think of the execution in device code as being essentially vectorized code, where each block or each wavefront is a thread, and that thread is operating on a 64-wide SIMD. That's sometimes a useful conceptual thing. The reason that the blocks are split into wavefronts is because we have very fast context switching. So if a wavefront stalls on a data dependency, it's fetching memory from the main GPU memory, then the CU can quickly context switch to another wavefront, which could continue its execution. Because we execute in 64-wide SIMDs, it is good practice to make the block size a multiple of 64 and have multiple wavefronts within each block so that the CUs can context switch between them. So how do we allocate and manage device memory? The host side code has an API that instructs the runtime to allocate memory on the device. This is done through a hip malloc call. And in this code snippet, I'll just give an example of allocating usual host memory through a malloc and then allocating device memory via hip malloc. And then they're freed in very analogous ways via hip free. Moving memory between the host and device is done through a hip memcopy call. In this call, we instruct the runtime where each of the pointers reside. So in the first example, to copy data between from the host to the device, we give a pointer to the device, followed by a pointer to the host memory, the amount of memory we'd like to move, followed by a flag that called hip memcopy host to device, which is to instruct hip memcopy that we are copying from a host pointer to a device pointer. And the following two examples are copying from device to host and copying from device pointer to device pointer. We also support copying 2D segments of arrays via hipmemcopy2D, and this just takes additional arguments to the pitch of both the destination and the source arrays, as well as the number of rows we'd like to copy from that two-dimensional array. This is a very blast-like call. It's good practice to error check all of our API calls, and most HIP API functions return an error code of type HIP error _T. This has a defined HIP success value if the API function returned error free, and otherwise it returns a non-zero error code. We can peek at or get the last error via HIP get last error and HIP peek last error. And we can also get a corresponding error string for each error code via, say, a simple hash define check, where we query the HIP error status and report an error and abort if we encounter an error.
That should be a HIP peak last error should have two E's. That's just a typo. Sorry.
We've reached the peak of our last error.
Yeah.
All right. In a very simple, high-level way, this is how we would put it all together, and this is a simple example of what a GPU-enabled HIP code may look like. So we start with our main function and include our HIP runtime header with HIP slash HIP runtime. This will be located in your Rockham path, which is by default installed in /op/Rockham in Ubuntu. So we would start by first allocating some memory, both on host and device, and checking our error codes as we do so. Ellipses, sometime later after filling the data, will move that data to the device via hip memcopy, launch our kernel to do some work on that device, and then copy the result back. And then sometime later, once we've used our data to some satisfying way in our application, we'll clean up after ourselves. Somewhere else in my code, my kernel is declared. Could be in a separate file, could just be above my main function. And finally, there's a hash define for my error checking. So this, at a 10,000-foot view, would be what most applications may resemble when offloading some GPU-accelerated portion to a GPU kernel.